This module will talk about identifying and evaluating business opportunities, because in entrepreneurship, you need to be able to determine the business that you're going to develop on the most fertile ground. That is the business that is most profitable and will attract more customers. Because as Peter Drucker said, the aim of a business is not to create a product, but to create customers. So basically, there are two aspects of a business opportunity. First of all, is the business. The business stands on its own, while the entrepreneur or the venture team starts on its own. So the business opportunity presents a fertile ground on which you build your venture, and it also shapes the identity of your firm. So you need to structure yourself and the business such that you are able to really gain as much as you can, and you're able to position your firm's identity in a way that would attract customers and people will know about your business. So for this module, we'll be talking about the opportunity exploitation map. So I will be discussing something called technology fungibility. So meaning that a technology can be applied to different markets. So it depends on which market you choose or which market you focus on. And the choice of your market will be as a result of some evaluation and study, so that you stick to one market that is most fertile. And with time, you're going to assess that market. If if you succeed, you stick to the market and later on diversify. Otherwise, you just pivot as you test another market and see if it's profitable. So it has been discovered in research that most entrepreneurs, their opportunity, the mainframe, their mindset is that given a technology, the opportunities are limited. So according to this graph, like about 50% of entrepreneurs, they just made use of like 1 to 9% of the opportunity in the vast opportunity space that is available. Why just 4.6% were able to like make use of up to 90% of the opportunity that is available based on the technology. So given a technology, there are a wide variety of opportunities, wide variety of markets that the technology can be applied to, which we call technology fungibility. But most entrepreneurs, they are just fixed on just one opportunity, just one market. And in this class, we'll be opening our mind to, like, giving any technology based on the business you want to embark on. This lecture will open your mind to search for the other opportunity in the opportunity space. We're also going to be talking about evaluating and testing potential target market. So it involved prototyping, because you first have to develop the product, at least a prototype, so that a customer can relate to that, or just to validate your idea, to see that at least it works. And you transfer the idea from pen and paper to physical product. Then depth research, field research, then cost estimates. Cost estimates is all about getting the price, the cost of production or the cost of bringing your product to life. So as a cost estimate and pricing as how much you sell each unit of the product, customer outreach involves distribution, then analysis that's reflecting and seeing the way forward. So we're going to be discussing about this. So the first thing we'll discuss is linking technologies and markets. The key issues are involved in product and underlying technology. So one important concept we're going to be learning is technology fungibility. So it's really a key issue in linking technologies and markets. So technological fungibility simply says that a technology can be applied to different markets. It can be applied to different products. Just a given technology can be combined to give different products and services. So, for instance, you have a product, and probably the product works on four different technologies, A, C, E, and D. So, and that product is going to, that technology is going to, those different four technologies are going to be combined to produce a product which will serve your target customers or users. So that's just one product. There are other ways at the technologies, the set of technologies can be combined to form product 2 and product 3. So as an entrepreneur, you should know these things, that it's not just like your mind frame, your mindset should not just be fixated on just one product. Because if you have the knowledge of different technologies and in your mind you're just thinking that it's only those products I want to work on. But if you're able to broaden your mind, you will discover that with the core technologies you know or you have, you can make different products and therefore serve different customers, because one product will serve a set of target customers you have in mind. While the different products as a result of different technology combinations will serve other sets of customers. So, and because in the first instance, we are going forward as based on the different technologies, you combine them to form a product which will serve the target customers. But you can go the other way around. You think about your customers or end users, you think about their pain, what they need, and you think about the problems and how to solve those problems. Then, based on that, you create the product to solve the problem. And obviously, products uses different technologies, so you can either go forward or backward in order to serve your customers or your end users. So, we're going to talk about Canon. Canon is a camera manufacturing. They produce cameras and they manufacture cameras, and they have three core technological competencies as precision magnetics, fine optics, and microelectronics. And using these different technologies, they're able to produce different camera sets, and not just cameras. They're able to produce printers, calculators, fax, copiers, and stepper aligners. For instance, to produce a camera, you just need precision magnetics and fine optics technology. Whereas if the camera is autofocus camera, then microelectronics will be included. So Canon is not just fixated on just like producing only cameras. So this is the technological competencies they have, and based on that, they are able to, based on that, they're able to branch out and produce other things, not just cameras, but also calculators. So, given the competencies you have, the technological competencies you have, you can combine them together to form different products that will serve different markets. Another example is a space shuttle. Another example is a space shuttle. It should dive. So this is used to protect the space shuttle from the excessive heat of the sun in the orbit. Thus, the heat can be up to 2,000 degrees Celsius, very hot, and so it's used to protect the space shuttle from the excessive heat or cold from the sun. When it enters into the orbit. But this heat shield tells it has other markets, because one market is catalytic converters, so it can be used in the automobile industry. So they make use of catalytic converters to expel the exhaust gas from the car to the atmosphere, which is could be very hot. Another market, so it is used in the automobile industry. So the heat shield tanks can also be used in refrigerators to keep the contents of the refrigerator cool or cold. Then it can also be used in the production of chimneys. So as an entrepreneur, it's not just only one market that you should just fix your mind on. You should look for different markets, then see which one is the most fertile to start with or to test your idea on. So in order to analyze your market, you can think of how large is the market. For instance, the heat shield tiles, it's probably you can just sell like 20,000 to a space shuttle agency, and probably there are just four space shuttle agencies that would buy it. So probably throughout the lifetime of your business, you can just sell at 40,000. But in the automobile industry, it's like you can sell more, but the competition, there is more competition, it's more competitive because they are already existing catalytic converters. So how will you enter the market? How will you break into the market and grow in the market? And also you think about the application in refrigerators. So probably that is less competitive. So you think about your growth ambition and what it means for my organizational identity. So like as a manufacturer of the product, people working for you, like in the heat shield tiles, that's like in the aerospace industry, and for the catalytic converter in the automobile industry. So do you want to identify yourself in a particular industry or another industry? So there's a concept called delinking and relinking. So in order to be able to know the available opportunities that the different combinations of your technology can achieve, we are going to use the concept of relinking and delinking. So most times innovators, they think of their technology just a specific market, but we've discovered that our technologies are just a combination of what technology can serve different markets. So we need to understand leveraging the potential of the technology and its market application have to be decoupled, because the mindset of most entrepreneurs is that, okay, you want to serve a market and you need this technology. But in order to know the available opportunity space and to really determine which market is the most fertile, you have to delink your technology resource from the market. So after delinking that, you're going to think of how the particular technology can serve different markets. Then after that, you relink it to the specific market application you are interested in. So delinking. So the first instance, in your mind, the technology you have and the markets you want to serve is linked. So the linking helps you to understand the technology in its own right. So is it a specific technology, or is it general technology? Is it unique, or how can it be adapted or expanded to other potential applications? That's the process of delinking. So delinking helps you to look at the technology on its own, like just in its own right, and the potential applications technology can have. And in the linking, you search for the market application of that technology resource. So which markets can it serve, not just the markets you had in mind, because you've already delinked it from that market you had in mind previously. So you're able to look at other potential market applications and you search for opportunities therein. So after that, you are going to relink it to your specific market application you want to embark on. So for instance, one example is the carbon fiber reinforced plastic. It was developed in the 1950s and it was majorly used in airplane production. But it was just like 15 years after when the main application, the application that created the most fertile market, the most fertile or the most profitable market, was in sports application, like to make shuttles. So this is the this is one application where delinking and relinking can make you to see different opportunities. Like in this case, the carbon fiber reinforced plastic was delinked from the application that it was based on, which manufacturers used on, which is in airplane and airplane materials, and it was linked to sporting jets. So that's, and this application ended up being very profitable compared to its previous use. So as we've discussed, relinking and delinking helps you to determine the most profitable where you are going to start, and it also helps you to shape the identity of your venture as so how people see yourself. So it will help you to determine how people will see you and how you also are going to view yourself. So relinking and delinking is very, very important in that sense, because It helps you to see what you didn't see initially. So we're looking at the key factors affecting opportunity identification. So most people think that some factors that most people, when they identify opportunities, they just feel that probably it's just stumbling on an opportunity. So probably it's just by chance. And some people think it's by luck. You just think of an idea. But there are other factors involved. So you should not just wait for luck. And different factors, they shape opportunity identification. So the factors are affected by the type, the number, and the variety. So the key elements arising from opportunity identification, affecting opportunity identification, are alertness. So to be alert means to be awake, to really know what is happening around you. Because it's those people that are alert, they're actively searching for opportunities, for business opportunities that find it. So the other key factors are pure knowledge, that's your previous knowledge and your cognitive ability. So the ability to think outside the box. So alertness. So alertness is just the ability to identify opportunities without searching. Just, for instance, it just means probably you stumbled upon an idea. For instance, IKEA. So they sell furniture and they sell modular furniture. So it was, the idea was actually stumbled upon by a co-worker when he bought a piece of furniture that had to grip the legs of the table so that it can enter a car. So he thought about designing furniture, tables and chairs that are modular, which you can just assemble, put in your car or just take around, then reassemble in your house or office. So that is what the alertness does. Then pure knowledge is, it involves two things. Knowledge of the customer's problem and knowledge of the market also. So it involves, it's not homogeneous, but it's heterogeneous knowledge background. So probably your education, knowledge from your education, your social status, your industry experience, your age. It can also be internal or external. For instance, getting knowledge by reading blog posts, blog posts and newspapers. So those are the key drivers. For instance, doing an engineering course will make you to be more aware of the engineering problems that are available, then you build your business around how to solve those problems. Then cognitive ability will also influence, is also a key driver to the opportunity. For instance, if you are asked how many straight lines do you need to link these 25 dots without lifting up the pen from the paper. So different people will approach it based on their different cognitive ability and creativity. For instance, you can link it with straight lines like this so that the lines touch each of the dots. Another is to, so that will give you like six lines, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So it's given 9 lines. So to reduce the number of lines, you can do it this way, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So another way is that you can fold it like a cone and spiral, draw a spiral line around each dot. Another way is that you can fold it up. Another way is that you can fold it up and the 25 dots as a single dot. Just fold up the paper, then pass a single line around it. Another one is that you can use a very thick marker to just draw a line across. So, depending on your creativity level, you can approach the same problem differently. For instance, a stent is a splint placed inside a doctor canal or blood vessel to aid in the relief and obstruction. So this company EndoArt, they used it. It can be used by surgeons for cerebral vascular diseases, for heart diseases, to remove obstructions from grafts, so from the blood vessels in the thigh, from the heart, or the brain. And typically, anything that's can be anywhere there is a flow to remove the obstruction from the flow. So you have to broaden your vision of the opportunity landscape. So by staying alert, you're able to stumble upon opportunities, and when you're alert, you see opportunities more easily. And you are able to, when you are alert, you also, you're not just thinking about the past or the present, you also anticipate the future. So, anticipating the future, anticipating the present is also staying alert. So, how you interpret things, and for instance, if you see, are you a person that sees a cup half full or half empty? Then for the knowledge, because knowledge determines the is a key driver for opportunity identification. So you can acquire knowledge internally from probably through education or through reading. Probably you want to start a business in the medical field, you read medical books, or you're interested in the automobile field. So you read automobile books. Then it can also be external, as seeking knowledge from others, those people that have more knowledge than you, or are more advanced, or they have knowledge in the area you want to work on. So you involve others. Then you also, your cognitive ability, if you want to improve your cognitive ability, you look at problems from different horizons, different angles. You zoom in and out of, zoomed in and zoomed out view of the problems. Then, after, because we talked about relinking and delinking, so in relinking and delinking, you isolate the technology from the market. So that will make you to identify different markets that same technology you have or you want to use can serve. And you evaluate each market. And after evaluating the market, you choose a particular market, for instance, the M3. You focus on it, you do market research and testing. Then if the idea, if it's profitable, if you discover that it's fertile, it's viable, then you can later decide to test the other markets which you thought of initially. Or if the idea did not succeed, then you'd be pivot. they will test another market on that same technology and later on to see how it goes. So that is an advantage of taking the approach of relinking and delinking. So basically, the mind is your limit based on if you are alert, if you broaden your knowledge, and also you improve your cognitive ability and creativity. So we talk about market opportunity evaluation. So choosing which market to explore, which opportunity to explore, depends on your cognitive ability, and it also depends on which market you want to serve after doing some preliminary evaluation, which we discussed previously. So you have to think of two things in terms of the organization and in terms of you. So in terms of the organization, after considering the different markets and after linking the technology from the market, after linking the technology from the market which you initially proposed, you have different markets available. Then you determine or you think about which is the most fertile and which is the most profitable, and which markets do you want your organization to be identified with? So that's what you think in terms of the organization. And for you, you think about which market or which domain are you most passionate about. For instance, a market can be very, very fertile based on your estimate, but probably you are not passionate about it. And you have to think about, based on that, will you still go on with that market, or you try and create passion in that market that is most profitable? So those are the questions you need to ask. And in order to assess your opportunities, so if that opportunity is really, really fertile, you have to look at these five things: the customer's perspective, the market's perspective, economic perspective, exploitation perspective, and the venture development perspective. For instance, for the customer perspective, how strong is the customer's thing? So, for instance, is the customer, is it going to pay because it doesn't have your product, or because your product is not available? And is your product a kind of product that the customer will say that I must have this, or I should have this, or I may have this? So is it really, really solving a customer's pain? So that's from the customer. And the first thing is from the side of the customer, because as Peter Drucker said, the main aim of establishing a business is not to create a product, but to get customers. So is the customer really benefiting from that product? And if from the customer's perspective, it's really solving their pain or their problem, then it's, you know, that is a very profitable business. It's something that you can go into. But if it's something that is not really solving their pain or their problem, then maybe when you are advertising, you'd advertise in a way that would create a need, so that the customers will know that they have to get this product. So from the market perspective, what is the market size? So the available market size, and that's the current market size. What is the growth rate of this market? over time. So, like, how many product quantities will I be able to serve, and will I be able to meet the demand for the market? And from the economic perspective, what is the cost estimate? So what is the price that is the cost estimate, that is the cost of producing the product? So what's your profit margin and the speed of revenue? So when you analyze this and see that it's in your favor, you can get the money to start off, and after that your margin is enough to sustain you, then you know that the business is good, you're good to go. And the exploitation perspective, can you develop the desired competencies? So the technologies, for instance, if it's a phone or a software needs updates. So you have to keep on updating, because if you don't update it, then the product will like not work properly, and your competitors will have an edge over you. Then what are the chances of you winning in the market? What do you have that other competitors don't have? Then for the venture development perspective, we think about the window of opportunity and how you can branch in into new segments, how you can pivot probably when the window of opportunity is gone. So every business has its own window of opportunity in which you can get profits over a fixed period of time. So you look at the window of opportunity and you say that, okay, will I be able to be stable financially during this time of where the window of opportunity of the business is open? Then after that, probably I need to pivot, or I need to diversify into other areas based on that same technology. So basically, thinking about all those things we discussed, you just use a combination of your intuition and knowledge to determine what is best for you. So we've seen these framework options. So based on our previous discussion on the customer's perspective, the economic perspective, expectation perspective, so you choose the market which is most profitable, which is most fertile, or which you can reach a compromise, probably you are more passionate about and is also profitable, and you focus on that market, and later on the other markets that same technology can serve, you can decide to diversify in order to grow your company and to grow your business. So we talk about the opportunity exploitation roadmap and test your market, which is a very important concept, because you have to test your market in order to identify the customer's need. Because as entrepreneurs, we're just like in our own box, because we have an idea we are proud of, and we know how the product works, and we are the ones that develop the product. So we take critics, we take them really personal, and probably we might say that, okay, I don't want to talk to customers because I know that my product is the best. But you have to do market research, you have to talk to the customers, because you have to, you know, that because by talking to the customers, you are testing your market, and you are also determining if it is a profitable business. Because at the end of the day, it's the same customers that are going to buy your product. Because main aim of establishing a business is not to create a product, but is to create customers. So at the end of the day, the customers that are buying your products, and so you need to relate your idea with them. And you're not only doing that, you're not only relating with the customers just for market testing, because you are also doing market research because you want to get some information from the customers. And the information you want to get from the customers, you want to look at the demand. Is will our product be in high demand? Are there, you want to look at the competition, are there other available products that can compete either favorably or less favorably with our product? Want feedback. So you develop a prototype, you take it to the customers and see what's their general take, what do they feel about it? Are there other products out there that can do better things? You want to look about the value it adds to the customers. You also want to talk about the distribution, like those similar products that exist in the market. How do the customer, how do they buy it? How do they get those products? We want to look at the marketing tools we can employ to advertise our products. And also want to look at other issues like regulation and purchasing behavior over time. So the customers can they are pessimistic, they have their own mindset. Given that the product is new, they may not want to accept it initially, they may be skeptical about it, but their opinion is also relevant. So you think of customers as your friends and not as enemies because of the information you want to get from them. So want to do market research, want to do market testing. So there are several steps involved. First of all is creating the prototype. That's not like the original, because the customers, they really need to see something. It's not that you transfer the idea from pen and paper to like a real product. Then after that, you do depth research, log on to your computer, log on to your computer and get information. You can also get local information too. So if like local information of already existing product based on your geographical location, and if the products are not available in your geographical location, you can think, you can do researching and look for and do the text research in the other geographical location, how the customers, how they use the products in the other geographical locations. If there's no current research on how the product is being used in the geographical location you want to use it, then after that you go to the market, do field research. That's you get information from the customers about advertising, distribution, the prices, and how typically all the customers, how they use the product and how to get the product out to the customers. Then you estimate your cost. So the cost of production, the cost of initial production, the overhead cost, the office space, the salaries as you need. After that, you also estimate the price of the product. That's the price of the individual unit the product will cost. So frequent approaches is to say that okay, my cost, the cost of the item will be the cost of producing each unit plus X, and maybe X is 20% of the cost. So X is basically your profit. Another approach may be probably there are other competitors that sell similar products and probably want to reduce your price, and you say that, okay, I will say that the price of one unit is the price of the competitors minus X. So X is like 10% of the price of 10% of the price of minus the price of what the competitor is selling it. Another approach is very, very low price. So there are problems with this approach is because if you say that, okay, I want my product to be the cost of production of producing one unit plus X, that's maybe my profit margin, the profit I want to make on each unit. If your product is very valuable and is meeting customer demand, customer's pain, is solving a customer's pain, the customers might be willing to pay far, far higher than the price you are proposing. So they can pay higher because they really need the product. It's really doing them good, and you are shortchanging yourself by doing that. Another problem with this approach is looking at the price of your competitors and reducing it. Another problem with that is that it's your own product may even be more valuable. We have more quality than the competitor's product. So why doing that to yourself? So yeah, those are the potential problems of these approaches. Then, and that is why market research is important. So another step is to reach out to customers. So the rule of thumb is to get 50 customers. They look at the product, they see the product, they assess it, they give you valuable feedback of how they feel about it, if they are willing to pay for it. So the rule of thumb is to get 50 customers, but if you don't have up to if you are serving businesses, not customers, just make sure that you may not be able to get up to 50, but just make sure that you talk to the person that has the buying decision, that talk to the person that is willing to actually pay for that product, that is what the person that's going to pay for the product. And the last step is analysis. So all the previous research you've been doing, text, markets, research, you just collate all of them together and analyze the data. Then, based on that, you are going to determine if the idea is or if the market is viable for that technology. So, if based on all these 7-step analysis it is not viable, probably you move to the plan B or the next step. So, probably this can be your plan B. So, when you test this market initially through the 7 steps we just discussed, if it's not viable, probably you can move to your plan B, which is this. But if this is viable, then you can engage in the production of this and actually start this business opportunity. Then with time, with time you're going to move to the other market and test the other market. So my time is over. So next week we're going to continue from there.